Ladies and gentlemen, this is the state of the scene.
Yo, what the fuck is up, Warped Tour? The state of the scene at SOTS Podcast on all social media. Sam here with Marcos.
What's up?
So, here's the deal this week. We're actually technically off. We're recording this in advance, and we're bringing to you two brand new reviews. New album from Stan Atlantic, new album from Throne. Hottest band in pop punk, hottest band in metalcore, right here on the state of the scene. So if any other interesting news happened, everyone just pretend it didn't, and we'll talk about it the following week when we get back. If you'd like additional content from us, patreon.com/SOTS podcast for only $3 a month. You'll get deluxe episodes of the show. We just put up the state of pop punk. This week, we've got the state of metalcore going up. Or maybe they'll both be up. Maybe I'll just put them both up and they'll just both be there and you'll just be able to listen to both of them. Maybe. I don't know. Go to patreon.com/SOTS podcast to find out. If you listen to the show on Apple or Spotify, leave 5 stars. If you're watching on YouTube, at SOTS Podcast YT, please give us a thumbs up. Every other link you need, whatever other bullshit we have, in the description of this episode. Playlist, merch, Discord, blah, blah, blah. So let's get right the fuck into it, Margos. We're going to start with a review of the brand new record from Stand Atlantic, Was Here.
This is the Sydney Outfit's fourth studio album, arriving the 23rd of August via Hopeless Records. Was Here consists of 15 tracks and is the much-anticipated album, follow-up to 2022's Fear LP.
Yeah. I remember that one. F-E-A-R. Do you remember what that stands for?
Fondly. Fuck everything and run.
Yeah, that's right. Good pull.
A few snippets from the album story. Courtesy of a rock sound via Jack Rogers, who wrote it. By putting so much of themselves into this record, there's a real sense of how things were before and how they are now when you look at Stand Atlantic. And that's not just an outside observation. It's something that Bonnie feels inherently. Through the process of making Was Here, she realized that she had become something that she didn't want to be. A version of herself that felt like a stranger, a version of herself that she didn't particularly like. Match that with spotting graffiti the band had left on the walls of venues across the world from previous visits whilst on tour again, it allowed her to consider even more so how different a person she had become without realizing. The weight of that is a lot to take in, and the grieving process is even harder to fathom.
Can we have a soft pause here?
No.
I really love the idea of a band tagging the venues that, I mean, across the street, whatever, yeah. But like tagging the places that they visited. That's a fun idea.
I didn't realize that Stan Atlantic like did so much graffiti.
Like they rolled that way.
They got every city.
Does it kind of
every
make,
city?
Does it kind of make them cooler? Like a little bit.
It makes them pretty cool.
It makes them kind of cool.
Pretty cool. A quote from Bonnie. We started to realize how blatantly I had really killed a certain part of myself off through this album. I felt like I was no longer the person that I was years before. It hadn't felt like a gradual growth into this cool person that I am really proud of being. It felt like there was a huge black spot in my life where I went so inward and I was not okay. There was a time when I felt like a shell of a person and a shell of who I was. I was grieving the person I used to be so badly because I didn't recognize the person that I was now. The album story continues here. There was only one way to really make sense of such a shift, and that was to materialize it. Turn the feeling into something real that could not just adorn the cover of the record, but also show Bonnie that the version of herself that had struggled through was gone for good and she could move on from it. And that was to literally kill the band off. That's why the artwork for Was Here, showing the quartet lined up on the ground with blood splattered all over them and crunchy. Their surroundings is so graphic. It was a brutal execution that not only represents the way in which the band has shifted from who they were, but also the harsh reality that once that person is dead, there's no coming back.
So dramatic.
Right? One final quote from Bonnie here from that album story. I went through so much shit. I just wanted to be able to hold this album in my hands, look at the person on the front, and see them lying there from a completely different perspective. Bonnie comments. It also tied in sonically with the Forget Everything You Know About Stand Atlantic, because we are a completely different band at this point. We've explored such different depths now. Final end of the quote there.
Okay, so a lot to take in here.
Yeah, and here we are left with 15 tracks, couple that we've heard now for nearly a year, a number that we have never heard before.
Right. So this album is, we're meant to interpret this as a complete rebirth of the band, right?
Well, it's funny too. Like
per the press release.
I saw the Was Here and that album artwork, and I'm just like, yeah, this is just dope. Not realizing all of the meaning it would actually have behind it.
I mean, aesthetically, it does just feel cool, right? Yeah. Like, it's very cool artwork. It's probably maybe my favorite artwork of the year so far, to be
Bloodied
fair.
Bloodied band members always hits.
Right. It's powerful. Like, yeah. it pops, right? And it's like an all-white background, and then it's just the blood, whatever. But it's an interesting thing to sort of have in the back of your mind that how I meant to interpret this album is that, like, in some capacity, this is a new version of Stand Atlantic, with the old version of Stand Atlantic having been killed off and dragged away with their bloody corpses across the front of this album. I feel like, to some level, I do read that in this album, where it doesn't feel a lot like the old Stand Atlantic that appears to be a lot more experimentation. We are sort of like branching out into other styles of music, and it's probably the most interesting aspect of this record for me are the instances where this band are really doing things I haven't heard Stand Atlantic do before, right?
And they're doing it often.
Yeah, and they're doing it off, and they're doing it early, right?
Sure.
I think little things that really stood out to me, like right at the top, coming from Wake Up, Sit Down, Shut Up, and Frenemies, were, and probably Into Girls as well, for what it's worth, they are the electronic elements that they're sort of bringing in, the sort of like little production touches that they're putting on top of their music, right? This is not as much a straightforward sort of pop punk. It's not just letting the hooks do a lot of the heavy lifting. Like, we have a little bit more of like a layered style here. And I think it helps bring a lot of the aspects of Stand Atlantic that I already like the vocals, for example. It helps make them pop in different ways. Like, it just gives the songs more body, right? Like, there's more happening here for me to feel, for me to like glom onto.
There's so much to return to. I finished this album and I just kept listening to it again and again and again. The replay value is off the charts, and a lot of it has to do with some of that production value. You highlighted those three songs at the top, and I think Frenemies is like the specific one where every time I listen to that song, I just feel like I pick up on something different that I hadn't heard before. And to me, those are the types of albums I always value the most, are the ones that I can
keep return to and find something
going
new.
Going back to the well and just finding something different. Just always being, you know, satiated and satisfied. And I think that extends to just the overall variety on this album. A track like Warzone is so far and away different from a song like Love You Anyway, which are all both completely different to 17 and then 17 Reprise, especially like subject matter wise. So there's just a lot of like different faces of Stan Atlantic that
we're
seeing on
this
album.
Of this band that we haven't had before. Yeah.
Well, the cool thing is like, it's not even like a jack of all trades, master of none. It's anything this band sets out to accomplish, they pretty much fucking knock it out.
This band is still anchored by their sort of pop punk prowess, right? Like, sure. They still know how to write really good hooks. They still have this quirk that comes in the lyrical like writing styles of Bonnie, and that voice from Bonnie in particular is still incredibly powerful and maybe one of the most exciting voices in pop punk in general. So it's like they have a lot of things they can fall back on that are dependable, that I think allow them to sort of branch out and try new things, because as long as it's like anchored by the things that they're already very good at, there's not really a fear that they're going to just sort of like float off into some sort of like space that like they just don't really have anything endearing about
but
them.
It's cool, right? Because then you can also bring in people like Polaris and have them really like up the ante, up the stakes, the heaviness of a track, and it's still completely sounds at home on this record.
The angst of this album really stands out, right? Like, yeah. It feels much more angrier than anything we've seen from this band in the past, right? Which maybe also ties into that artwork as well, right? Like, maybe it all is a little telling of what the experience was going to be.
I think that's also one of the key things to what makes Stand Atlantic who they are. Like, you talk about, like, Bonnie's lyrics and the vocals and, like, there's cool production, cool riffage, but it's also always the attitude that comes with every song, and that's something that is inherent to this band. Like, without that attitude, all of these songs would be different.
I think everything really comes together in Kiss and Killer Cobras in particular, because it's so many of like the old and the new smashing together. Like, we have this version of Stand Atlantic that feels a little more like angry and like just sort of like amped up, and then you have like the intangibles that you've come to like know about this band, like the really like abstract lyricism and stuff like that. And I think everything sort of like sings with one another in Kiss and Killer Cobras. But I think where this album most stands out to me and my favorite aspects of it are its where it veers furthest off into opposite ends of the spectrum, like Criminal in particular, which has, for all intents and purposes, a 30-second moment of metalcore, is a really standout track because it blends the two sort of like most popular styles of music in the scene into one really like fun and interesting song. It veers into like a Day to Remember territory where you have something that is pop punk meets metalcore, and it does it really successfully. But then alternatively, something like Love You Anyway, which is just sort of like the ballad straight up like love song on this record, I also think works immensely well.
Right. That it sounds like a fucking The Band Camino song at times, you mm-hmm. know, like I love that they can sort of just morph into whatever the
they really
song
showcase
needs
a lot
them
of
to
range
be.
On here. Yeah. Yes, a lot of range on here. And Girls is like one of the most abstract songs I've ever heard them do, and I really enjoy that as well too. And Paris and Bruises are perfect for that track.
Freaking Out is fairly straightforward. It ends up being my favorite track on here though. It's just got an absolutely killer, like, it's essentially the chorus, but it's like the oohs after.
Freaking Out feels like it could have been a single if it wasn't.
Yeah, it's just got a very bouncy energy to it. It's extremely reminiscent for me of another band that's similar to Stand Atlantic, is a bit of a chameleon. They just kind of go off and do whatever they want and sound different, even though they started as a pop punk band, which is Boston Manor.
Right.
And then I think the one song I do want to talk about here is 17, which is Stand Atlantic at their absolute most vulnerable.
Right. Which, lyrically, a lot less abstract than all of their other songs.
Fairly straightforward.
Like a strong margin, yeah.
Yeah. But I highlight this one mainly just because I'm always very appreciative of when a band bears their all in this way.
Mm-hmm.
Because I know it's obviously probably an extremely difficult thing to do. And I do think that this band puts together a really compelling song around some extremely vulnerable and touching and horrific subject matter. And then really just completely knocks the ball out of the park in 17, reprise, one take, stripped back, similar subject matter again, just kind of just Bonnie bearing her all. And it's really touching. One of the more just sadder songs this band's written, and for good reason when you hear the subject matter, but a very powerful moment knowing that this is essentially them taking something back, whatever they can take back, right?
And I think it's even more poignant because it exists in a sea of all these other songs that, like, even at their angstiest, also still have this level of silliness, like Kill Her.
I didn't realize how good Warzone was when I first heard it.
Warzone is a great
but
song.
Fucking
I think there was a little bit of transition here that you sort of like had to acclimate yourself to like the new version of Stan Atlantic, where like now that I'm there, I'm much more in tune with everything that they're doing than I was when they were sort of drip feeding us these singles.
Yeah. I'm like a cyclone entering a Warzone is like a lyric I've just not been able to peel from my memory and my mind.
But even going from like 17 and 17 Reprise immediately into like GAG is such a crazy like transition.
Girl's a gun. I feel like I get a little lost with Gag and Rockstar towards the end.
No, Gag is strong. Gag is strong. Rockstar's not my favorite track.
I might need to re-listen.
Though I do like dropping Cockstar in the year of our Lord 2024.
I love it. Love it. But overall, yeah, this has got some of this band's strongest material.
It's a lot of fun, and it keeps your attention for 15 tracks, too, which
and
I
also,
think is impressive.
I really enjoyed Fear when that came out. I think it's a really solid album.
This band...
they leveled up here.
I think has consistently gotten better with every single release. I think I feel better about Stand Atlantic every time I hear a new one of their albums.
Yeah.
And I think this is going to be incredibly like promising for their career in particular. I would not be surprised if a lot of people feel similarly to us and really enjoy this album as well.
Sweet. That's all I had to say on it.
Margos, so that gives us one other album, which would be the brand new release from Throne, Excessive Guilt.
Excessive Guilt. Sun waking up in a pool of sweat, but this air's never end. When I close my eyes and go straight to hell, so I stay away to blood for love. It's the Swedish Outfits, Stockholm, by the way. Stockholm, Sweden. Debut studio album, arriving the 30th of August via Arising Empire Records. Excessive Guilt consists of 11 tracks and is the follow-up to 2022's debut EP, Extended Pain. And between that EP and this album, it houses all of this band's material, and it amounts to like a whopping 30 minutes. Total.
It is insane looking at the timestamps for like the track listing on this album. Like seeing one singular song go like 2.5 minutes and then like seven other songs come under 2 minutes.
Yeah.
It's like you're looking at this album and it's like, wow, I can listen to this like five times in the next hour is incredible.
Now you at home, you're asking yourself, have I ever listened to Throne before? Odds are yes. The answer is duh. They're currently one of our scene's biggest streaming darlings. Which is a bit of a just an all-around surprise. They just happen to be doing extremely well. They've amassed a ton of fucking listens over the years. The short year that they've been around, like 2021, 2022, 23, 24, I think
there is a simplicity to how this band has presented themselves and their style of music and their entrance into metalcore at this specific time, and like it's really just endeared and enticed people to like connect with what they're doing.
I think they're also a very no-nonsense approach too.
Yes, and I think there's something about their style. Like Throne for me is the type of band where I could see a lot of people saying, oh yeah, they're the best band on this lineup, even though they're the opening band.
Yeah.
Like they're one of those bands that I see people like getting very excited for.
Speaking of,
they have that makeup.
Currently opening or about to be opening every major tour between now and all of 2025, which is half truth and half me being a betting man. Like, you know, you had the same idea there. This is a band that's going to be on every bill. A lot of people are going to be showing up to that tour just for them.
I see a lot of similarities for them coming out on the scene as I saw like the very sort of no-nonsense metalcore that we were getting out of like Alpha Wolf and Dealer when they first came around.
Yeah, good examples. It's funny that Alpha Wolf has kind of turned that around and
yeah, and they've expanded, but that's kind of how all of these bands go, right? Like even go back and think to yourself, like Knocked Loose, like when they first came on the scene, like even though they were like sort of this hardcore metalcore hybrid, like they had a sort of no nonsense pissed off attitude that like is really engaging to the metalcore audience, which is why like they have such a like fundamental like following, like such a like strong following, like really early on in their career, because what they're doing just sort of like, it almost speaks to like your like the inside, like the animal in you, right? Like there's nothing here to like churn through or sort of like overthink. It is just like angry fucking metalcore. And that's what this album is for like 22 fucking minutes. It is the most pissed off shit you're ever going to hear. It doesn't even get to 22.
It's only 20.
I was trying to do like the math in my head, like sort of by myself, like adding all the timestamps together. But yeah, I think that like it is impressive how much this band is able to get done in 20 minutes. Because by the time you're finished, it doesn't necessarily feel like this album's too short. It feels like it has 100% gotten its point across.
Yeah, it feels like a full journey. We talk about how this band takes a no-nonsense approach, but they're still doing some really cool things. On the Verge is one of my favorite tracks from this band, just period, full stop. And it has like this silly little sample at the top that's just really repetitive and really cool. And
I like that this band isn't like energetic. Scared to embrace sort of like the production flourishes that I feel like a lot of other bands in their space would be like, no nonsense, not interested in. Like Throne is willing to say like, yeah, we are like what feels like a bare bones metalcore band, but we're not a modern metalcore act. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like you're going to hear like a very strong clean cut production in here. You're going to hear like some of those producer elements, like sort of come to life in this band. This band is produced by their drummer, by the way.
Yeah. Buster. He's also the drummer for Vicharta and Humanity's Last Breath. That last one I'm less familiar with, but also produces the band. Yeah. So I guess everything in house. And then Marcus, their vocalist, I think is also an underappreciated talent, even though this band is getting their due.
Yeah. Like it's almost hard to call them underappreciated, yeah. Right? Because they've had like such a like groundswell of support really early on in their career. But I think it's earned, you know. One of my favorite things that this band kind of does, and they do it on a couple tracks on here, is that they'll have these like hard stop moments where like we do this complete shift into like a different tempo, and it like works so phenomenally well because it comes out of nowhere and it's done within such a short span of time. It makes the songs feel much bigger and longer than they actually are, because you have like this big moment that happens all in the span of like such a short time.
It almost makes the album just feel like one long 20-minute track that's just constantly switching up. I think that's important to emphasize, too. It's like this band does accomplish a lot with every song not sounding too... Like, it all sounds a place on this album.
It's hard for them to feel like anything... It's hard for anything to feel overwrought or repetitive when the songs are that short. So I think that works to their benefit. I also think it works to the benefit of them getting their point across, right? Like, you feel like the emotional impact of this album because of how direct and to the point it is. Like, we are not being subtle about our emotions in any way, and we're telling you these like small vignettes and small stories about like our mental space all within this short span of time. I think the track that really stood out the most for me on this entire record was Nights, because I feel like it had more of an element, like a very soft element of like storytelling more than some of the other songs on here. And I think that like even lyrically, though, for the most part, this band is not rich in metaphor or even has the time to be rich in metaphor. They do have like some very like hard cutting lines.
They do. They also have like a lot of can't drown my demons, they know how to swim type stuff that like is a little tiresome.
Okay, fair. And then maybe some of it could be attributed almost to feeling like sort of mosh collie in some element.
Yeah, which
right?
is always welcome. That's fine.
It's what they're going for, right? So it's like everything about this band feels so well considered that they almost managed to skirt a lot of criticisms because of some of the choices they've made on this record. And yes, it's very easy to just get lost in how absolutely punchy they are as a metalcore band, that it's like, what is there to be critical of here? I simply feel like I'm being like emotionally fueled by what I'm being provided here.
Do you? Because I do. And I'm curious if you look forward to the future now. As far as like, I'm just fascinated by what the next step might be.
Like, they're a very curious band.
What do they sound like on the next album?
Because
what step do they take?
They don't have, at least as much as I've been able to tell, a lot of like presence in them as individuals. There doesn't feel like there's like a lot of storytelling happening in any of their music videos. Like, so much of this band just feels like a, like, what's the best way to put it? It's almost like an animated husk of like a metalcore band. Like, they don't let a lot of personality in. They almost let a lot of just like, let the music do this talking for them.
And that
so
works
it's hard to
for
like,
a lot of people.
Right. It's hard to gleam a lot of like what this band's like vision is. It almost just seems like it's surface level. Like, hey, we make really like pissed off, angry fucking metalcore. And like, I'm okay with that. There's a lot of room for that. You know
yeah,
what I mean?
I'm here for it.
Yeah. So it's there's a simplicity to Throne that I really enjoy. I think there is obviously room to expand upon it. I don't know what the future looks like for them though.
Very promising though.
Yeah. So those albums will both be out the Friday that you're listening to this. Check them out. Let us know what you think. Comment on the YouTube video at SOTS Podcast YT. Leave a thumbs up if you enjoyed the show. We'll be back with a regularly scheduled episode the following week, talking about all the news we missed and reviewing some brand new releases as well. Bye, guys.
Good boy.